All right, so now that we have all the assets ready for our scene, we just need to put them all together and kind of like play with the arrangement and the poses of the different assets. So that's something that is relatively easy. So what I'm going to do is open up my subtool palette. I'm going to turn off my worm pieces as well as my rocks here. And I'm going to use my character just to bring it closer here. I'm going to make him sort of stand on one of these dunes here. So let's push him here, and I'm going to rotate it 180 degrees, roughly. Again, it doesn't have to be precise at this point. By the way, the crazy camera movement, or not crazy, but the smooth movement of that camera is due to a little gadget that I have called the Space Mouse. It's a 3D mouse by 3D Connection. I do have a tutorial on the YouTube channel if you want to have a look at that one. But yeah, that's basically what I use for this type of nice smooth movement of the camera. All right, so now I have my character in place, and then I can just go ahead and pose my worm. Now with the worm, one thing that I'm going to suggest is to apply the nanomesh, because remember, these are just like, you know, teeth that are part of a particle system in a way. So I would just recommend to apply it before you go ahead and pose the character. So I'm going to go to the nanomesh palette here, and I'm going to click on inventory. And I'm going to click on one to mesh. So now each one of these objects, or each one of these teeth, is actually geometry that you can deform, right? Let's go ahead and switch this line off so you can see. So at this point, what we can do is hold Control and Shift to select the base mesh. And we can either split it or we can delete it, up to you. I prefer to sort of split things. So we can go to the split palette, split hidden. And that way, if I want to create new teeth or use that geometry again, I have it. In fact, let's go ahead and create a folder with this. And I'm going to call it OR as originals. Hide this. And that way, if I ever need to use it, I can go ahead and come up, come back and do it. That's pretty much it. So let's go ahead and now pose the worm. So for this, I prefer to use the Transpose Master because it allows me to combine things together. So I'm just going to go ahead and hide everything that I don't need. So just the worm. I'm going to click on C plugin, click on Transpose Master, and click on T pose mesh. So this basically sends whatever I have visible, as you can see, just the bits that make the worm, is going to send them to the low resolution mesh. That's why this looks faceted. And it's also going to combine it into a single mesh. So this is temporary. But this is great because now we can go ahead and bring in the gizmo 3D. And because this gizmo was originally aligned with this cylinder, we can use some of these gizmo deformers to change it. So I'm going to turn off perspective first, click on the gear icon, and use the bend curve. So this is going to add a couple of points in here that you can just go ahead and use them to rotate and move around. But the key here is that you can use this cone to increase the resolution of the curve. So I'm going to click and drag to create more of these points. And now I can just sort of push this up. And I'm going to make something similar to what I have in my original concept here, so that the worm is kind of like lifting from the dunes of the desert and almost like looking down on the character, right? So something like this. Here's the concept. And the cool thing about this is that you can move the points as well from any angle. And I just want to add a tiny bit of rotation here, just so to make it a bit more interesting. And also, it kind of like goes with the concept here. All right, so something like this. Maybe it's a little bit too much, but it doesn't matter. What you can do is, after you get the initial block out ready, you can increase the resolution of the curve a little bit more, and that allows you to fine tune all of this even more. So I'm just going to rotate things around. Now, an extra little tip that I'm going to give you when you're posing things with the bend curve, like if you follow this process, is that every time that you click or you select one of these points, you have additional cones. So the yellow one allows you to add a little bit of twist. So I'm going to add, just for the sake of demo again, just add a bit of twist so that it's not perfect. And that also helps to hide a little bit of the radial symmetry that we use for the details. Let's go ahead and click on accept. Let's move this out of the way now. All right, so as you can see, this is pretty easy. And you know, you end up like posing something that is quite complex, like those teeth in there, fairly simple, just because it is combined into a single object. All right, so once I'm happy with this, what I'll do is I'm going to click on the C plugin palette, and I'm going to click on T pose to sub T. This is going to take this pose and it's going to send it to the original file that we're working with. All right, so as you can see, it takes about 9 seconds to do that. And the cool thing as well is that we maintain the subdivision level. So again, this is my worm pose. And if I go to geometry, I have all my subdivision levels. So if I need to, I can keep, you know, subdividing if I need to, or adding more points, or not points, more details if I needed to. But that is basically the pose, and it's ready. So let's go ahead and enable the dunes and the character. So that's not too bad. I think we need to increase the size of the dunes, actually. So let's click on the gizmo. When I scale that quite a bit, just to make it a little bit easier for the character to move around. It's going to be slightly different from my original concept, but you get the idea. Let's grab the character and let's push him back a bit. In fact, let's take the entire sand dune and scale it and bring it closer. All right, something like that. All right, with the character, this is the next bit, just to try to place him in a way that kind of like makes sense, that he can sort of walk these massive dunes. Okay, I think that works. All right, so that's kind of like what I have here. It's, the rotation of the worms is slightly more exaggerated, and I feel it's a bit fatter than this one, but that's the same thing. So the last step here of this part is just to fine tune the assembly of this scene. So what I'm gonna do is bring in my move brush. I wanna make sure I have AccuCurve enabled as well, just so we have a nice pointy effect. I'm gonna select my dunes or the desert. I'm gonna go to the lowest subdivision level so I can manipulate this a little bit easier. I'm gonna increase my brush size, and I'm gonna try to hide the worm, create kind of like the sand drifting off, or like, you know, falling from the volume of the worm. All right, maybe increase the amount a little bit more, and I'm just gonna add just pulling and pushing just to fine tune, like I said, all the sand dunes, kind of like I don't know, it's just like adding a bit of the sand on top, and like literally like the worm is pushing and creating those sand dunes as it moves around. I don't know if this makes sense. I don't know if I'm explaining this correctly, but I just want to integrate this with the scene. That's the whole point. All right, something like that is not, again, it's not, you know, you can spend more time doing this, but I think this works. All right. And we can go to the high subdivision level just to make sure that everything works nicely. So the next thing I'm going to do is bring in my particles, which are those rocks. Remember, this is just a sphere using nanomesh. Where are we? Nanomesh here. So I covered this in previous parts of the tutorial. So it's just a sphere that has a bunch of these nanomesh objects. So let's show placement off, and I'm gonna use this sphere, sort of like place it whatever I want to, whatever I want to create this sort of effect of like rocks falling. And this is the cool thing about this. I'm gonna duplicate it so I have two sets of particles, let's say. I'm gonna hide the second one, go to the first one, and I'm gonna use the move brush, and I'm just going to pull and push to literally deform that sphere and try to give some directionality to these rocks. So the cool thing again is that we're not manipulating individual rocks, so the consistency and the size of those rocks is maintained. We're just playing around with the placement based on a single sphere. I'm gonna turn off the dune because it's a little bit annoying to, yeah, there we go. It's a little bit easier like that. All right, so pretty cool stuff. Now let me just show you how that looks. Let's show placement. So you see, it's just a completely distorted sphere, right? But again, this is just the placement, and you won't ever see this. It's just to place those, let's say, those particles. That's how I've been calling it. But the cool thing as well is that I have two, right? So I can enable the second one and bring in that maybe closer to the mouth, scale that up. And let's go ahead and use the move brush as well to just push this down. By the way, you can do this while the actual sphere is visible. All right, I think this is cool. Now, the reason I split it into two is because that way I can control the density of some of them. So if I select the first one, I can go back to my nanomesh And I can go ahead and click on this random distribution and increase it just so I have more or less, right? I can also say, you know what, this is a little bit too big. I'm gonna make it smaller. And that also contributes to that sense of scale between the massive worm and the character. So let's just reduce that slightly. Again, you can do this in post-production, you can paint them, but I just wanted to show you the process that I use, and I think it's quite powerful anyway. Okay, so now we can go ahead and enable the dunes, and let's turn perspective on. So that is pretty much our scene ready. And to wrap up this tutorial series, I'm going to show you how to add a little bit of polypaint to the scene and how to export it so that you can do a render in your preferred rendering software.